Hey guys, we are in the basement, and today, we're gonna do a John's Arcade on the road. That is right, guys, we're gonna hit the road, and this time we are going to Atlanta, Georgia. That's right, we're going to the Southern Fried Gameroom Expo. And yes, I filmed this video a long time ago. Actually, I was down there in June. Because I got a call from Preston. Preston Burt, of course, from the Gameroom Junkie podcast. He organizes this event called Southern Fried Gameroom Expo. Anyway, he gave me a call and said, "Hey, John, you want to come down here and speak at the Southern Fried Gameroom Expo?" I said, "Yes, I'd love to do that." So I had a great time, and I went down there, and I filmed all kinds of footage, and then I deleted it. I don't know what I did, but I accidentally just deleted the wrong partition on my camera. And I deleted the partition that had the footage from the event, and I was able to recover the footage, okay? I bought some commercial software, so in this video, we're gonna watch the footage that I recovered. And thank God I recovered it, because it was a great time, and I did a lot of cool things down there. And in this video, we're gonna hang out with Ben Heck. Of course, Ben Heck from The Ben Heck Show, I love him. Him and I did a crossover video already. We made that assisted device for Erie, one of my viewers, and that's on Ben Heck's channel, and also on my channel. And then also, when I was there, I said, "Hey, Ben, let's do a walkthrough. Why don't you and I walk through the event here, and let's talk about all the games." So we're gonna do that in this video. And then also, on the way to the event, in the car, I shared a ride with Dennis Nordman, who's a famed pinball designer, and also Greg Freres, who is a famed pinball artist. You know, Greg Freres actually did the Revenge from Mars artwork right here. So I got to share a car with him and Dennis Nordman. Of course, Dennis Nordman did Whitewater and Pirates of the Caribbean and all kinds of pinballs that everyone loves, and that was kind of cool. And then also in this video, I'm going to show you guys a little bit of when I was speaking, because it was kind of cool because Walter Day and Billy Mitchell interrupted my little speaking thing, and they came in there and they gave me my own Walter Day trading card, which was super cool. So that's going to be in this video. So all kinds of fun stuff, and you know, I get this award from Joel down there, and for some reason I kept wanting to call Joel Mike, and I don't know why, but Brother Joel, he gave me the Brother John 2015 Brown Paint Award of Excellence, and we'll see that in this video from the Georgia chapter of the John's Arcade Fan Club. So, in general, I had an awesome time down there. Everybody was so cool and so nice, and really, just a great bunch of collectors in that area. Really, just super, super nice guys. And I got to meet Wesley, the guy that I bought the computer space from. I mean, there's countless people I met. But anyway, enough of that. Why don't we just get in the car, let's hop on a plane, let's go to Atlanta and visit the Southern Fried Gameroom Expo 2015. And guys, buckle up. This is a fun one. All right, guys, let's hit the road. All right, guys, we landed in Atlanta. So there is a car waiting for me. I've been told it's a Lexus with a Papa John's pizza thing on the roof. And get this, I'm supposed to be sharing the car with Dennis Nordman and Greg Freres. Dennis Nordman, of course, a legendary pinball designer. He did Whitewater, Pirates of the Caribbean, stuff like that. And then Greg is an artist. Like, he did the back glass on my Revenge from Mars. So anyway, I gotta find these guys. I'm not sure if I'm on the right side or the wrong side. There's like two sides to this pickup area. All right, I found them. Here's our Lexus with the Papa John's sign on the top. We delivering some
Papa
pizza.
John's pizza.
All right, guys, we're in the car. I'm with Dennis Nordman, pinball legend, Greg Freres, pinball artist, and video game artist too, right? You did some Midway stuff?
Some stuff. Not animation, but...
Right. Yeah. Well, I have your art in my basement. I have a wrench from Mars. You did the back glass, right? So what, like, of all the art you've done, what are you most proud of? Anything?
Wow.
In particular?
That's a tough one.
Like, if you had to make a resume today, what would you put at the top?
Whoa Nellie, big juicy melon.
Whoa Nellie, of course.
Get attention, right?
Right. If you guys aren't aware, Stern just released a new pin that Dennis and Greg worked on called Whoa Nellie, and it's kind of like a throwback pin, right?
Absolutely.
And it's got a very unique kind of out-of-the-box feature. The bottom, it doesn't have legs. It has, like, crates.
Yeah, it's like a stack of fruit crates.
Right. So how is everyone receiving that pin pretty well? I mean, is that doing well for Stern?
It's starting to catch on.
Yeah?
Because it was so unique, I think, you know, the problem was people didn't know exactly what to expect.
Right.
With every show we go to now, they're starting to see the unique, special quality of it. And the people that are buying it love it.
I mean, awesome.
We're getting feedback from Facebook and stuff, and it's just, you know, everybody is amazed by not only the quality, but the playability and the fun factor. So
it's just good, simple fun. You don't have to think.
It's got score reels, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
was it hard to, like, go back in time and, like, create, like, score reels, like, in 2015?
Yeah, a little bit. We had to reinvent the wheel
Did
a
you?
Little bit.
Yeah.
No pun intended.
Did you have to make new parts and tooling and stuff to make that work? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yep, absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely.
And Dennis, you designed it and you did the art, Greg, is that right?
Uh-huh.
Yep. And, of course, Dennis, you're most famous maybe for Whitewater. Would you agree or no?
I guess I would agree, because that's the game I hear about the most, which is nice.
Yes, so. It is.
I can say I loved it immensely, with 7 reps, high five.
Yeah, no wonder you So the game is, so Whoa Nellie, it's not really a throwback, it's a blend of old and new.
Is that right? Okay, I haven't played it yet, so.
It plays very fast, like a modern game, but it's a simple play field, like an old game.
So right.
You can't really comprehend what it is until you actually play it.
Awesome.
And the people that play it say, wow, I'm surprised, this is really fun, because it's just, it's simple to understand, but difficult to master.
Sweet. So, of course, it'll be playable at the show, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'll do a full review of it when we're there.
Cool.
And I saw, like, pictures online. Sometimes it has legs and sometimes it has the crates. Is that an option, the crates? Or
it comes both ways.
It does, okay.
So, yeah, you can set it up the way you want it. If most operators probably won't want to put it on
legs.
Yeah.
Just to make it easy to move around, put it on, you know, a pin card under it. But home users are probably going to want to put it on the crate just to give it the initial look that
Right.
was designed
yeah,
into that, it.
Yeah, like your vision, yeah.
Yep.
All right, cool. So, well, thanks, guys, for chatting with me.
Yeah, no problem. Good to meet you.
Yep. All right, we're going to keep on driving.
Not only 7 reps.
Thanks. All right, guys, we made it. We're in the hotel. That was a pretty awesome car ride, I have to say, with Greg Freres, and Dennis Nordman. So I'm gonna go down and check the show out, and not really sure what to expect, but it should be fun. Actually, where did I put my key? Must bring my key, that would be bad. So, all right, let's go down to the show and see what's going on. Pretty cool hotel. Whee! All right, guys, I'm here with Ben.
We're not in the basement.
We're at Southern Fried Gameroom Expo, and Ben, what do you think? It's pretty cool?
Yeah, well, the weather here in Atlanta is pretty warm. I would say it's around 92 degrees outside.
It's about to storm, by the way. So it's a pretty crazy show. I've had a lot of fun. I mean, we're in the parking lot. Look at all these, like, vehicles that are, I mean, these are all people that just brought games to make this show work. It's pretty crazy, right?
Yeah, I mean, people bring games and usually get free attendance for that. So
yeah.
That's what makes these shows tick, is actually having games.
Exactly.
All brought by mostly fans. I mean, you have things like Marco bringing, like, eight walking
right.
heads or kisses, but
yeah.
Yeah, it's mostly fan-driven, and we appreciate people who bring games because we didn't.
We did not. We couldn't fit it in our carry-on. I could. It just would not. Yeah. It wouldn't fit in the little box.
Can you imagine if Thomas tried to take it in the overhead bin? Everyone would be like, come on.
It's just a cabaret. Calm yeah. down. So I thought we'd walk through, and we can just kind of talk about what's there and all that. And
yeah, let's take a look.
And Ben, we should preface all this, because you and I have talked about this before. You're not really a video game arcade guy. Is that true?
Not anymore.
Are you a pin snob?
Yes, I am a pin snob.
Are you a pin snob,
and I
really?
I told you why I'm on the Skype. It's because the amount of square footage that pins take up have a much higher value per square foot.
Is that right? It's just all economics?
It's purely economically driven.
You made a spreadsheet to determine why you should not collect video games? Is that what happened?
Well, I mean, like things like Simpsons are still worth money. But, you know, I always wonder if video games will become less and less desirable and then they'll rebound, like, in price.
Oh, I think they're going up already.
Yeah.
Because, like Wreck-It Ralph and now even Pixels, the movies coming
yeah,
out. I
yeah.
think there's more awareness and talk about the Donkey Kongs and the Pac-Mans and all that.
Right.
You know?
I mean, if you go back to a certain area or a certain era when they were like, you know, smashing like gambling machines and pinball machines
yeah.
like in the 50s.
Right.
So games from that era are probably more rare just because so many of them were destroyed.
Exactly. Yeah. And if you had to pick one video game though, what's your favorite?
My favorite arcade game?
Yes.
Afterburner 2.
Afterburner 2.
I love that.
Why
game?
2, not 1?
Aren't they the same thing?
I don't know. Are they? Is there
no,
a two and a one?
Yeah, Afterburner 1 was only in Japan, I think.
Okay.
Afterburner 2 is basically the American version with more levels.
Oh, is that right? I never knew that. Yeah. I don't really follow the Sega games like that.
I just love how
fast. You're a Sega guy, right?
I had a Genesis back in the day before I had a Super Nintendo.
Yeah.
Because Sonic the Hedgehog was faster. And Mario was just like, I'm a plumber. I'm so slow.
But Ben, that's why I didn't like Sonic, because it was too hard. It was just...
It wasn't hard.
Yes, it was. I didn't feel like you were controlling Sonic. He was just like on a roller coaster ride.
That's a good point.
What?
No, that's
right?
Good, yeah, it's like on rails.
Right. It did seem that way to me. So anyway, all right, let's walk through this place. We're going to go in through the back door, like kind of Goodfellas style here. Go through the kitchen.
Do I look funny to you?
All right, so.
Oh, air conditioning.
Yes.
That's why people come to these events.
So this is like, is this the main room, I guess?
I think so.
Yeah, so they got a lot of pinballs over here. And by the way, we should look at this one. This is Whoa Nellie, which is Dennis Nordman and Greg Freres. This is their new pin that Stern released. It's kind of, it looks kind of like an EM with score reels, but it's a very modern pin.
It started as an EM. They took a game called Continental Cafe, and they re-themed it. Well,
is that right?
Yes. They didn't re-theme the layout. They took all the mechanics and the quote-unquote logic of that EM, and they made it into a game. But then they created a board set, which is done by Kerry Emmy, who works at IBM. He created a board set to do the four other prototypes that they made. And then Stern turned it into a modern spike system, so it uses the same board set as WWE and KISS.
I think it's uber cool. I really do.
Yeah, yeah. They had a lot of controversy about the melon woman and her melons.
Lighten up.
Yeah, it's a throwback to the 70s.
Right,
games,
exactly.
Yeah. And you think, you don't actually see any boobs. I mean, she's
no,
holding melon.
Exactly.
Yeah, well, I mean, the colors are great. Like, it's like Greg's like, hey, I can draw something. I don't have to, like, make Photoshop collages.
Right.
Yeah.
It's real art. It's
yeah,
not from
yeah.
some style guide with, you know,
right.
Photoshop files and raster images.
Yes.
And then there's an option to put it on this wood crate or have legs.
I believe it comes with the wood crate.
Yeah, I was asking them in the car. And I guess it comes with both, and you have the choice to do it.
And
way.
The can actually comes with that crushed beer can.
I know. Greg was telling me earlier that they like made those cans.
Right. If the unfolded version of it is like a big juicy melon beer can.
And they stick the one can not crushed in the coin box. He said.
Yep. I believe this box, the crate. Obviously, they made it by hand for the prototypes, but the crate is something they found at IKEA and like rebadged with the graphics.
Oh, is that right?
That's what I heard. Yeah.
That's cool. So this is the Marco booth, which is like heavy on Stern. Of course, Marco's an awesome distributor of parts and stuff. Great online resource. I've ordered from them plenty of times. What's your favorite?
We're in Atlanta, there's a zombie.
Ah!
It had to be done.
So the new KISS is here, which
yeah.
is kind of a big deal. What
I
do you think?
It a couple times.
You like it?
It's very Borg in layout.
It's very Borg.
It's definitely a John Borg game. It's pretty fun. I haven't gotten too deep into it. I like the Gene Simmons kick out with his mouth.
Yeah, that is totally cool.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. It's pretty fun. I played it twice. I want to play it some more.
It's a crazy theme in 2015.
This one opened up.
Oh.
Hey, can we take a look at the, can we rip off the spike system and take a look? Yeah, cracker open.
Is this their new board set or something?
Yeah, yeah. It should be.
What was it called before, like White Star or
Sam.
Something? Oh, Sam?
Because
what's
Gary's
White Star?
White Star was from like Guns N' Roses up to right before Pirates.
Okay.
And then Sam, which is named after his dad, is was like Pirates of the Caribbean up till whatever was before this.
It's up in the line down, so it's not
okay.
Right.
Wow, that's crazy. There's nothing in there, and the LEDs are on.
There's not nothing in there.
I know, but the LEDs that light up the back glass are part of the PCB.
Yeah, and if you see, they have a single power supply here.
Hang on.
They have a 48 volt switch power supply here. Yeah. And it's got a fan
switching,
on it. So they bring in the 48 volts here and they knock it down to the other voltages. So everything is done right here. And then it's 400 megahertz ARM running Linux off the SD card for updates. And then everything is serialized.
There's an SD card, so there's no more EEPROMs or anything. That's how you update the code?
This is going to be flash memory right there, or RAM.
Okay.
And there's your ARM.
But to update the game now, it's SD card instead of...
I don't know, it's SD or USB.
Both.
Okay.
I like how they just use these surface mount LEDs here. Look at that.
That's crazy to me that the LEDs that light up the back glass are on the...
Well, one thing people forget about with PCBs, a lot of the cost is just the surface area of the PCB, how big it is.
Yeah.
So the smaller you can make it, the cheaper it is.
Gotcha.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Wow, that's cool.
Well, I don't know if I have it on this one, but at least the one I saw inside of the, what was it? The pin system, they had depopulated HDMI. So when they eventually switched to video, I can't remember where it would be. It's somewhere on here. It was, maybe they changed it. But yeah, isn't that cool?
It's totally cool.
Yeah.
Pretty crazy. I mean, in comparison to like a 90s Williams pin, you open up the back glass, it's just like a rat's nest.
Well, the Williams stuff was like evolved over the years,
yeah.
So even
it would have got here.
Right, right. Well, no, they just kept adding shit onto it over and over.
Right.
They kept adding things onto it over and over and over, and it was kind of an amalgamation, but this is like from the ground up. It's very cool.
Awesome. Thanks for showing us that.
Yeah, no problem, guys.
All right, so they got a ton of pins here. They have Medieval Madness repros, right? Somewhere?
One over there.
Over there, the first one.
Oh, okay.
I'll take the original.
Really?
Yeah.
So Ben, some guy just told me, he said he'd rather take the original.
I've only played this a couple times.
I love the game. You don't like it?
It's okay.
It's just okay?
I actually prefer to play this on Pinball Arcade more than in reality.
Is that right?
That's sick.
Yeah. Alright, it looks cool to me.
You can tell this is a remake by the powder code.
Yeah.
And they have an LCD here, but the code doesn't have color dots yet, although they are making a video upgrade.
Oh, they are?
Software upgrade to make it color.
Okay.
I'm sure it's some sort of thing where they're trying to do the color themselves instead of using what Color DMD did for some sort of legal purpose.
Right.
So, I don't know.
I don't know. I like it.
You should buy one.
I would love to. It's a little spendy.
I think they even use certain color LEDs here to replicate kind of the feel of... I mean, these are all LED illuminated.
Right.
But they wanted it to kind of appear like bulbs.
It does look like bulbs.
Yeah.
It doesn't read as a LED. It looks incandescent.
I think because people were so paranoid about surface mount LEDs, there's like three LEDs under each lamp. So if one fails, the other two will compensate for it.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go down here.
All right.
So Adam's Family, I mean, of course, you gotta have that. Monster Bash. I like Monster Bash, you dig that?
Oh yeah, that's good.
Of course.
I like Monster Bash.
Yes, everyone likes Adam's Family.
Yeah.
How about Gilligan's Island? You a fan?
I've only ever played it once.
Really?
Yeah. That was actually the first Williams game with a DMD. It wasn't Terminator 2 like people think, it was actually Gilligan's Island.
Is that true?
Yes. Came out slightly.
Oh yeah, I heard that, yeah. I think Steve Ritchie, I think I heard that interview.
Yeah.
Alright, Indiana Jones.
I never really cared for that one.
It's funny you say that, because I've played it a few times, it's cool. To me it's the best theme ever. Because Raiders of the Lost Ark is my favorite movie.
Yeah.
That and Blues Brothers. So.
But as a pin, I just don't really like it.
Interesting.
It's like, I know.
It's awesome.
It's awesome?
It's awesome.
You like it? It's a little flat for you. Metallica.
I don't know, I'm just not into wide bodies.
Yeah. Metallica, I think, is kind of neat. Do you like that one?
Yeah, it's okay.
It's okay?
There's not a lot of stuff in it. It seems kind of empty. Yeah.
Would you rather have AC/DC?
Yes, I would.
You would?
Oh, definitely.
Tales of Arabian Night. I've never been hot on that pin.
It looks amazing. Of course, you pop into a game. It looks amazing.
Yes. That's all we'll say.
I'd love to have one. I mean, it looks so cool.
It does look really cool.
You know, they keep talking about like PC 2.0.
Yeah.
And I keep telling Aaron, it's like, what you really got to do is you got to make boards. And just like Ride a Pinbot 2.0, update rules for games like Arabian Nights. Like, Arabian Nights or Theater Magic with good rules would be like the top games.
Yes.
Because there's so much
stuff in
them. The
playfield's so great. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and if you just had better rules, it'd be amazing.
Right, just make it that much deeper, yeah. Junkyard. I played that in a bar in Chicago. I don't mind it.
The theme is confusing.
Yeah.
You know?
It's confusing?
Yeah, it's like, what are you doing? You're built. Yeah, I find it confusing.
You're in a junkyard.
But you're building a junk copter to escape, and I don't get it.
Elvira. Cool, Elvira and the Pyre Monsters, of course.
Not really one of my favorite System 11s.
No?
Elvira's the same age as my mom, so I really can't get too hot and bothered about her.
All right, well, how about Scared Stiff?
Same thing.
Really?
Yeah, I'm not into it. Sorry, Dennis and Greg.
Yes. Tron Legacy. Everyone seems to like that game.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I love the theme.
The layout's basically Funhouse, if you think about it.
Yeah. A lot of the games are basically Funhouse or Whirlwind.
What? Yeah, copy what works.
Right. Yeah. All right, Star Trek, that's the old Bally one.
Yeah, nah,
it's
not
a little,
fan.
It's a little meh. And then here's the Data East one.
I kind of wanted to buy one of these, but I don't think so.
The Data East one?
Yeah, because it's the old crew.
Right.
But now I'm like, nah.
Eh. Are you a Star Trek guy?
Yeah, I like Star Trek.
Okay.
If anything, I would get the new one.
Yeah, yeah.
I almost bought one.
The new one's slick.
I like it a lot.
How about the Williams one?
Not a fan.
Really?
It's a wide body.
I feel the same way, actually, but...
I just don't care, and it's really hard to maintain.
Is it really?
There's tons of optos under the playfield.
Ah.
And, yeah.
And that's the new Stern one. And then Attack from Mars is a grail for me.
Oh, yeah.
And Ben has awesome. That.
Yeah, I do.
I have Revenge. That was the closest I could afford.
Well, now with all the remakes coming out, the price is coming down.
Is it really?
Well, it's still a lot of money.
Are they making a remake of that? There's rumors? Maybe.
I've heard the next remake is Fathom, actually.
Fathom? What's
of
that?
Of all things, that was a Valley game for like 82.
Really?
That was one with the mermaids like catching the guy in the water.
Yeah, I can picture it.
Yeah.
I don't know it, though.
I would assume they're going to remake this thing. The thing with the remakes, though, is 8,000, like when Medieval Madness was getting remade, it's like a beat up one was like $7,000.
Right.
A nice one was like $12,000. So right. An $8,000 Medieval Madness was a bargain.
Yeah.
But now the prices have been deflated, so it's no longer a bargain.
Right.
So how many remakes can you make until you depress the prices so much that it's no longer a bargain at $8,000?
Yeah. That's going to happen. Yep.
Yeah.
All right, so over here, these are like indie games, like kind of homemade stuff.
Right.
Solomon's Temple. It's pretty cool. I like the scene.
Yeah.
Default Dan.
Thank you, because some of the inspiration for this cabinet design.
Oh, really? Oh, cool.
You mean some of the inspiration wasn't from Williams?
So are they raiding Solomon's Temple in modern times? So they must be, as a pith helmet on.
Actually, the way the story goes is you're an explorer back in the 1930s.
Yeah.
Lost in the catacombs trying to find the Ark of the Covenant.
And you think King Solomon has it?
Well, so according to legend...
According to legend, he did have it for a while.
That's right.
Yeah. Oh, wait, no, you gotta see it like Indiana Jones.
Well, it's like the Indiana Jones font.
Yeah, yeah.
King Solomon had the Ark of the Covenant for 100 years, and then it was lost to the sands of time.
Thanks, man.
Yeah. Thank you.
And then Default Dan.
What, he's like, can't pay his home mortgage?
That was good, man.
The game is too big to fail.
Right.
And then this all day.
And then Munch. I was talking to a guy that made this game, and he said he made it, and he didn't realize that he had copied Nibbler. He didn't realize that he did it.
Huh.
He kind of did it in the back.
So it's a snake game, huh?
It's just like Nibbler. It's actually kind of neat. Try it, Ben.
All right. Oh, but it's Nibbler in a maze.
Well, yeah, right. I think he kind of executed it pretty well. I like
it. Yeah, the snake's cute.
Yeah.
I assume I have to watch out for the spiky guy.
Yeah.
Nom, nom, nom.
Grab the apples.
What happens if I hit my tail?
Yeah, you die.
Okay.
Yeah. And then Fix It Felix. I'm assuming this is not a Disney one. I went back to earlier. There's like a PC back there.
So people reprogrammed this, right?
Yeah, well, the Disney code leaked. The files leaked. The EXE file. I actually have it. The game's really one-dimensional. It just doesn't change.
Yeah. I agree. It's like an impression of a classic game. I don't think it would necessarily work as one.
Right, right. Yeah, exactly. All right, so here's a bunch of new stuff. Star Wars Trilogy. What are you a fan?
Well, this game isn't new. It's like from 97.
Yeah. Well, new to me, I mean.
That's pretty cool.
It's totally cool.
Yeah. What's this thing?
I don't know. I've never seen that before. Frenzy Express?
Oh, it's got a roller controller on it. Oh, it's like kind of like a skating game or something. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, he's like on a scooter.
Oh, it's ice.
It's like a Razor scooter.
It can't be too new. It's pretty cheap.
Yeah. Interesting. Hydro Thunder, Midway Classic racing game with boots. Yeah. Time Crisis 2, everyone loves that. Great shooter.
It's cool how you can push the pedal
and you can pop out.
People, yeah.
And then Pac-Man Battle Royale. I guess Billy Mitchell played everybody earlier today.
Yeah, I saw them filming that.
Yeah.
Oh, look at the tables look like Pac-Man.
Yeah. And this is like the giant one. They have a little one that's like a cocktail.
This goes into like a GameWorks or something?
Yeah, like a Dave & Buster's type deal.
I'm sure that costs a pretty penny.
Yeah, no kidding. All right, so over here, Route 66, Time Crisis, ATV Track. Yeah, these are pretty cool games.
How do they ship these games?
I know.
They're huge.
That's right. I mean, really, all the community brought this stuff here.
Do these games earn enough? I mean, this is probably like a $15,000 game here. I mean,
yeah, no kidding.
It earned enough, apparently?
I guess. All right, so over here, some pins, some wood rail stuff, some old pins.
Oh, yeah.
Are you into that stuff?
Nope.
You like that stuff, Ben?
Nah, it's too old.
It's too old and slow for me.
It's so terrible.
It's cool though. I mean, I can appreciate
the cigarette burn.
I appreciate the history, but it's too slow.
Yeah.
And then pitching back game here. I do like these games.
Oh, it's the predecessor to Slugfest.
Yes, right.
Yeah.
It doesn't spit baseball
Dennis
cards.
Dennis is working at something like this.
So over here, all the classics. Ben, what do you think? I mean, these are.
I liked Pole Position a lot.
That's my favorite, man.
Yeah.
I mean, these are the usual suspects. A lot of the common games. I mean, is there anything that pops out?
I've never seen that before.
Oh, that's the Versus Dual System upright. I had the cocktail version.
Right.
And the upright
is just the upright version of it?
This is the upright, yeah. And so on this system, there's one PCB, and you could have two sets of ROMs to play two unique games, or you could have a set of ROMs that talk to each other. So you could play baseball head-to-head, and you each get your own screen.
Is a Nintendo inside?
Yeah, it's a... It's not quite the NES. The games are actually a little harder and different.
Okay. Oh, because it's arcade. You gotta take the money.
Right. So, usual suspects here though: Frogger, Punch Out, Centipede. I love Punch Out. You like Punch Out?
I like the Nintendo version. I never played the arcade.
Oh, really?
I've only seen it a few times.
Yeah, I used to have that in my basement. It's really hard.
Is it heavy?
Rampage. We're gonna be talking about Rampage later.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Dragon's Lair 2.
Yes.
It was made right after the first one, but shelved for what, like 6 years?
Yeah. And then like Leland bought Cinematronics and then resurrected it. And my friend Jay has one. It's cool. It's a lot harder than the original, I think.
And it's linear too, right? The scenes are always in the same order.
I'm not positive about that. I know that the original, they randomized the...
Yeah, once you got in. Or they would flip the video button,
yeah.
Right.
And by the way, that sign is from my website. They printed my PDF.
Yeah, that's Felix, right?
Yeah. I vectorized it and put it on my site to download. I could tell because of the line. I put that line in there.
Is that your copyright?
No, I put the line because the original one had like a line in it.
Oh, like a bad scan.
Like a bad bad Xerox.
That Dragon's Lair was quite the thing back in the day.
I love Dragon's Lair. I don't know why it's out of order, but I have a Dragon's Lair at home and I really like it. And I have an original laser display.
Dragon's Lair is one of two games in the Smithsonian.
Is that right?
Dragon's Lair and Pong.
No kidding.
The two arcade games in the Smithsonian.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I love Tron, by the way. Are you a Tron fan?
No, I am not.
You're not?
No, it's terrible, right?
The movie or the game or both?
Both.
Really?
If I would have seen it when I was six, I would have loved it.
No.
But I didn't.
I saw it when I was like eight or whatever.
Okay, yeah. I'm sure I would have eaten it up.
Yeah. But the thing is, when I saw it as a kid, I didn't get it. It was too slow. The movie is really slow.
It's like The Matrix, but not done very well.
Right.
Plot-wise.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then this has the NCOM marquee, which is a reproduction.
Okay.
Richard, this old game made those marquees.
What's this? David Warner was in it, right? Yeah.
I don't know. Is that who it is?
David Warner. Yeah, he was that guy on Titanic who was like had the gun and he was trying to shoot people.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't remember that.
David Warner. He was also in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Part 2.
Oh, he was
the original Ninja Turtles. Ben
Tapper.
I love Tapper.
That's the beer version, right?
Yeah. What's that? Yeah, that's the Budweiser. The they made a root beer one, too. Yeah. I have that one in my basement.
It's interesting how the sprites on the Midway games had higher resolution than the backgrounds.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, you can tell.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. All the MCR games, that's the hardware platform, they all have that kind of very similar look.
Yeah, yeah, like that Xenophobe game. Shit, I've played that a lot.
Yeah. All right, so Gauntlet 2. You strike me as a Gauntlet guy.
Yes, I did like Gauntlet.
I called it.
Yes.
Do you like the second or the first or both?
It doesn't really matter to me. Oh, Mad Planets, that game is good.
Yeah, I have that game. That game's awesome. Oh, I love that game. That's a beautiful Mad Planets, by the way. I think it's a repro.
It's gotta be.
Because someone just released the FPGA board that has all the Gauntlet games on it, and it's got, I suspect that's what's in there. That's my hunch. Qbert.
Yeah.
Gotta have Qbert.
Yeah, that's another guy.
It is, yeah. You can notice the same cabinet profile.
I really like the, speaking of people who also make pinballs, I like the Stern Berserk game.
Oh, yeah.
That was great.
That's classic.
With the tax or the
Yes.
Yeah.
And there's also an FPGA board now that has Berserk and Frenzy on it.
Is that the old Star Wars game?
It is, yeah.
All we ask is just jump to the back of the line and come play it again.
Yeah, that's the first Atari Star Wars vector game.
Oh, yeah.
You like that?
I should play it.
All right, play it.
For the adults, you got to have at least 8.6 million, and for the kids, you got to have at least...
Where's the start button?
It's the triggers.
1.6 million.
Maybe a hop. All right.
Yeah, I used to have this game in my basement, and I kind of lost interest in it.
Chewie, we're old!
Ah, get over here!
What do you think, Ben? You like it?
Oh, it's as I remember it. I'm not very good anymore, though. I like how the ship moves at a different perspective than the background.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
I like that.
That's pretty advanced, really.
Yeah, this is like what? This is like early 80s, right?
Yeah, 82 or something around
there. Well, it's color, like Asteroids wasn't in color.
Right, it's a color vector, usually an Amplifone or 6100 monitor.
So it has CMYK beam all being directed in a vector pattern.
Can you blow up the Death Star, Ben?
Not yet. It'll be just like Beggar's Canyon back home. Can I do a loop like Afterburner? Nope, I guess not. Oh, there's this perspective.
I have to say, watching you play this makes me miss mine.
You should pick one up. Oh, I gotta shoot these things.
I have you now.
Oh, you gotta do the R2. Wow! What happens if you don't shoot the exhaust port?
I don't actually know. I think you hit the wall,
you get
right?
Kicked off the force.
Shoot it!
Yeah!
There you
See
go.
In hell, Death Star.
Ben blew up the Death Star.
Oh, sweet. We gotta have the extra ring on it.
Good job, Ben.
Thanks.
You saved the universe.
Yay.
Or is it the galaxy? Who are you saving?
The galaxy universe.
All right, let's go over here. We're gonna do, there's a... So it's Iron Man and Mustang, new Sterns, pretty cool.
Yeah, they're pretty cool. Yeah. I played Mustang earlier. It's kind of growing on me. I'm not gonna buy one, but...
Yeah. No, I played it at Gameworks and didn't mind it at all.
Something's got a burned coil there. You can smell it a mile away.
Yeah. So there's a bunch of cocktails here. I used to have a Popeye cocktail. I'm not really a cocktail guide because it takes up too much space.
Yeah.
But you were telling me you had like a cocktail pinball.
I did. I used to have a circa 1931, which was the same as Roy Clark.
Yeah. Domino Man. Food Fight. Pac-Man with the LCD.
There's been a Food Fight before.
I mean, yeah, Food Fight's awesome. Huh. It's totally cool. You like the game?
You're it's alright.
Yeah.
I know what it is, yeah. This one looks like it's emulated.
Yeah, both these look like MAME, arcade classics and all that.
Oh, they got a Joust. That's not terrible.
Yeah, Joust pinball, super cool. There's like less than 500 of those.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty neat.
Can you play it single player, though?
No, I've heard it. You can. I don't think it's very playable, though. Want to try it, Ben?
Sure.
Hey, can you film us?
Sure. What are you guys doing?
We're doing a video for YouTube. This is Ben Heck.
Hi there.
Hello.
All right, let's try this. So how do we start, Ben?
I don't see any buttons on my side. Oh, there we go.
All right, so we're playing head-to-head here.
Are we?
I drained, yeah.
I don't seem to have any control.
Are your flippers working? Oh, did we start a one-player game?
I thought I pushed two.
Oh, look, so on a one-player game, I control all the flippers. Are you doing that or me?
No, I'm not.
Let it drain. Let's start a two-player game.
We had to wait for it to reset itself.
Oh, you did?
And then it started.
Yeah, press this when that's a two-player game. You're trying to, like, bat it back and forth into each other.
But how did you start, like, two players simultaneous? That one? Okay. All right, Ben, let's try this.
Now I have
it. All right, good. So we're trying to take each other down or something?
I guess.
Is it, like air hockey? You have to get it in your drain?
I don't know.
Oh, Ben! All right, that was cool. Yeah. I have to say, that was pretty cool, because
you gotta get it through the spinner.
You totally got it down my drain.
Whoa! Oh! I did the same problem.
Oh.
I have you now.
I like the sounds a lot.
Yeah, they sound like they're from the game. Joust.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of hard to get to those spinners. You gotta like backhand it.
Whoa, hello.
Oh.
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 Haha, now what?
So if I have both balls, you have to sit and wait,
yeah.
Right?
There you go.
Oh!
That's kind of cool.
It's totally cool.
Have you ever played flipper football? That last Capcom game before they went bust?
Is it the same setup as this? I think I saw one in Vegas.
No, it's not double under.
Oh, it's not. Okay.
But it's like you're trying to get balls past the drop target goalies.
Okay, no, I've never seen that.
It was like a huge flop in... didn't earn at all, probably because it was called flipper football and it was soccer in America.
Right.
But, like, at home use, like, multiple players, it's a blast. And they're cheap, too. You get, like, 100 grand. Anyway, it basically is a game that killed Capcom. That sound was intense.
Yeah, definitely. Game's over? Yeah. So is it like a time thing?
No, this is where it goes into Ballmageddon.
Oh, it does?
Yeah.
Ballmageddon? Oh, we have 30 seconds now to kill each other.
Okay. Ballmageddon. Oh, so the balls are like eggs, I guess.
Ben, you started in a movie called Ballmageddon, didn't you, in the 80s?
Oh, yeah. Chuck Norris. It's time for them to pay. Ballmageddon.
And that was in the trailer. I remember that.
Oh! Ballmageddon. Death Race 3000. Oh, there we go.
Ah, game over. That's right. Cool. Thanks, guy. Thanks a lot.
Take it easy.
I have to say, I kind of enjoy that in a way. I didn't know the rules or anything.
This would be better like college dorm, or not a dorm, but
right.
You know, where there's always going to be two people to play.
Right, exactly.
Hey, look, it's Billy Mitchell.
Hey, it's Billy Mitchell. Hi, Billy. How you doing?
I recognize you. You're 2,396.
I am, and you're number one.
I appreciate that.
We need to get Ben a trading card. Ben needs a trading card.
Walt, we have a trading card request here. He says he's
Ben, John, do you want a trading card?
He wants a trading card as John's assistant. John says he doesn't have a better assistant.
Heinrich von Heck.
Heinrich von Heck?
What the heck?
Heinrich von Heck?
Where's the Heinrich von?
Heinrich von?
Oh, that's my answer.
I was a Ludwig van Heck.
But for now, we're number one.
Yep. So what do you guys... So, Walter, I have to say, I really dig this new shirt. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. Well,
who did that? Who?
Well, what did they do?
I tried to get the one with Ben Heck on it, but they were out of them. So this is the only one we're able to come with.
That's really well executed, though.
No. This was done by Dan Turrell. Dan Turrell is the artist who's in England, in Litchfield, UK.
Okay.
Who does sports drawings. He draws, like, Joe Montana.
Oh, is that right?
He draws all sorts of things of the Patriots or the Green Bay Packers and stuff. And he volunteered to draw a whole set of cards.
That's awesome.
Let me see what we got over here.
And Ben, you bought some hot sauce earlier.
I did, and I put it on my hamburger.
Oh, he drew that too, huh?
Oh, here, I'm gonna put a dollar toward the card project.
Get this on tape, ladies and gentlemen.
20 would look a lot better.
Trading card project contribution.
I don't think dollars will fit. Only 20s fit in there.
Oh, it looks like a dollar fit in there.
And Ben, I mean, which hot sauce did you buy? You bought the
I bought this one.
The standard?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Before I had a bottle this size, but now I have like times that much.
And you're actually a fan of the sauce. You
it's okay. Yeah.
Well, you were telling me yesterday. I need hot sauce.
I like hot sauce. I would eat food if it was on fire, if it wouldn't like damage me. So
right.
So, like hot sauce.
So, all right, Walter. Thank you.
Later.
One second.
Yep. All right. I like this little Neo Geo.
Oh, that's cute.
Isn't that cute?
Yeah.
My friend Jay has one in his basement, and he put a stand on the bottom because it's so short.
Yeah.
He made a little base, but I really dig it.
Neo Geo is awesome.
Yeah, it is. Pac-Man Cabaret, Asteroids. So why don't we go over here in this room, and then I think that's kind of... Ben, you have to speak in a little bit. What time?
What is it?
It's a new Oculus. Are you telling me something?
I already asked these guys. They said you could jump ahead when I saw you walk by earlier.
What's happening here? Oh, you Oculus? Cool.
Yeah, this is new Retro Arcade. It's basically a whole new...
Is it doing front tracking as well?
Yes. All right. You haven't done DK2 yet?
I've still done 8.3.
So he's in a virtual arcade. Is that what's going on?
Yes. This is new Retro Arcade. Hold on. Let me get him ready. So look straight ahead. Sit up straight because I got to reposition you, which I've just... done there. Okay.
I want to look around the arcade.
Go ahead. You can just walk away. Just walk around with the Xbox controller.
Oh,
so
sweet.
This is Row and Row After Arcade, which is actually doing MAME and Super Nintendo emulation. And he could walk around. He could bowl if he wants. I don't recommend doing a physics test on here. I recommend playing one of the games. But it's basically like what's happening in these other rooms, just virtually.
Wow, that's pretty badass. I gotta say. So Ben, does it feel cool? Does it feel legit? Oh, you can't hear me?
I can hear you.
Oh.
Oh, there's a Super Nintendo here. Very cool. This is the DK2, right?
Thanks. Oh, yes, this is DK2. This one is slightly modified. Unfortunately, since we don't have internet, he's not getting like all the music, but it's got built-in headphones that another company here locally did. This is also a case I built so that we could run it. You press the X button to engage the game, and then you press the back button to add quarters.
Engage the game, but we just met.
This is a case that we made so that we could do mobile VR.
Move. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, the buttons and the joystick move, and it's pretty real.
So how does he start a game?
Oh, you have the depth tracking working on the front camera, right?
Yes.
All right, that makes sense.
He's playing it now.
I mean, Ben, do you feel like you're in an arcade playing Pac-Man?
It's not as smoky as it would have been back in the 80s.
I was explaining to these kids that there's too much neon as well. But that's not a bad thing. If we had more neon in the 80s, we totally would have added this much neon.
Oh, you have real-time reflections on the joystick?
Well, I didn't write this particular program, but yeah, it's using Unreal. And Unreal's real big on Unreal, like better textures and stuff. I prefer Unity when I develop, actually.
Ha-ha! Come and die, Ghost!
I mean, Ben, does the screen seem kind of far away?
Not really.
No?
I mean, the perspective is a little different. It's like I'm smaller than I really am. But he's pretty good.
The reason it looks bigger to you is that this is actually his top and his bottom of his peripheral vision.
Okay.
So he's actually focusing on about that much.
I see. Okay.
You're
basically so he doesn't see
what
as much.
The human eye looks like.
I see. Okay. Ben, is there gum anywhere on the cabinet, like on the top, or
there's a texture on it? I'm gonna look around this game room a little bit more, okay? Oh, you've got the old movie posters here. Nice.
There's a couple of Easter eggs. There's a phone with a busy signal, which I'm sure he doesn't even know. This kid over here doesn't know what it sounds like. And you get to take it, like put it on the receiver and stuff. It unlocks a couple of things, but nothing like
that. There's a cassette tape that I can pick up.
Yep.
All right.
If this was connected to
Ben, I like to see you press E to pick that up.
I don't have an E button.
E button would be B button, I think.
Oh, it's a flashlight.
That's
apparently
a flashlight so that when you play your Game Boy games, you can actually see them.
Oh, I can play this too, huh?
Yeah. I'm not sure which button he is. Trigger, maybe?
And these all work.
Yeah. And you can load up your own ROMs as well. So you can actually set this up so that it's your own arcade with your favorite games.
A leather couch in an arcade? Yeah, I wish.
This is a private arcade. You're going to scuff the floor.
That's pretty cool.
Cool. Well, I should let someone else give this a shot.
Yeah. All right, man. Thanks a lot.
I thought you were trying to
get it. All right, guys. This is Python Angelo's Pinball Circus. This is a reproduction. And Ben right now is trying to fix it. This has Ben's PCB in it that is also in America's Most Haunted and the Rob Zombie game, right? The Spooky Pinball?
Yep.
And then Paul, what's your role in this, Paul?
One of the engineers and programmers. And yeah, one of the team members.
And Paul was on those Pins and Vids DVDs,
right? Yep.
Who is the other guy in those videos?
Al Warner.
Al Warner, that's right. Yep. I have a couple of those. They're fun. That was like pre-YouTube almost, in a way.
Probably. It was 2005-ish.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you were releasing videos on DVD, yep. Which is
what's
crazy.
DVD?
I know.
For Pinball Hall of Fame, you know, for Tim Arnold.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll switch it back on.
So you guys are reproducing Pinball Circus, like, literally from scratch. Which is just amazing.
I still have nothing.
Yeah. Let me show you guys in the back here. Excuse me. Squeeze by. So back here, the pin score LED, flippy penis putt. I'm not sure what that's all about. And then it's got Ben's board down here. And a power supply, it looks like a couple power supplies and an audio amp. But I have to say, this is pretty exciting.
No, not that.
So Ben, what was wrong? Was it bad opto?
Yeah, I just to see if it was wired backwards, I wired it backwards.
And it fixed it?
No, it didn't. I mean, you'd be able to see it on your camera. Well, not with that light, you wouldn't.
Here.
Yeah, you'd be able to see it if it was actually emitting. So yeah, the one in the rear is emitting, this one's removed, and this one is not emitting, so we need to replace it or something. Oh, see, you can see the bit plane difference there, see the...
Yeah, okay. It was like sparkly, the...
Yeah, those like gaps in the bit plane. Yeah, see how those pixels just on or off right now? There's no shading applied.
Right.
When it switches to like one of our default videos from America's Most Haunted, you'll see the shading, see how it's all flat.
Right. So the code's not done. It's not telling the pixels to light at different...
Well, they just didn't... As you mentioned, they've converted lazily.
Right. It's not done.
Okay, if you can switch it off, I can swap it out.
Pretty awesome. So Ben, is this game any good? What do you think?
It's okay.
Yeah?
I mean, I don't know if Kiss is any good. It's a band.
I liked them when I was like five.
They're more of a brand than a band.
I do like the Gene Simmons head.
Just throw the ball. One.
Oh, right down the middle!
It should go like
bleh. It should make that sound. It's easy modification.
Oh, yeah.
Bleh. All right, guys, I had to stop here because they're selling game room tables for $175. But is it... Look it, guys, it wobbles. They all freaking wobble. Don't you get it? Every one of these tables wobbles. Look, it's not immune to it. And if I put a popcorn machine on here, this would absolutely be wobbling. But it's pretty cool though. It's like acrylic with these little like fiber optics type thing in there. But yes, right. It definitely wobbles. Actually, before we go to the pin room, I want to show you guys this. This is Lexi Lightspeed. This is actually a P-Rock platform.
Yes.
And it has a LCD as the play field, right?
Most of it. They use infrared tracking. That's how they know where the ball is moving.
That's pretty awesome. Yeah, they designed like a whole new flipper mechanism.
Well, yeah, because they can't drill through the LCD.
Ah.
So see how the actuators come from below?
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
And I was watching earlier, this whole drop target section comes up.
Yeah, each one of those comes up.
Yeah, it's like pretty neat.
You
basically you can like travel around the world or whatever.
Yeah.
The back of it changes, so if you want to change the game, you remove like the last third of it.
Right.
Yeah. So to swap the game out, you take the back third of the playfield out.
That's right.
And then the software, and that's it, right?
Yep. And plug it in, it'll recognize whatever else you got back there. Change out the game.
Yep.
The artwork on the side is magnetic, so it'll come right off too if you want to reskin it in seconds.
And originally, you didn't have a back box, and people gave you
people
crap,
complained.
Right?
It looked weird.
Yeah.
This is just to make people happy.
It looks good though. It was a good move. It looks traditional. Well, so cool, man.
There's no need for a store there because it's right down here.
Yep.
But awesome.
P3 was the name of the club in the TV show Charmed.
Oh, is that right?
Yes. It was always on before Law and Order.
Useless trivia.
Yeah, and it had Rose McGowan in it, so, you know.
Cool. Thanks, man.
Yeah.
House.
Yeah.
I mean.
Just like Tron.
Yes.
It's very similar.
It was
to
a Tron before Tron. F-14 Tomcat. Somehow.
That is.
Little Chief. Maverick.
You like Maverick?
No, I don't.
You like the movie?
No, I don't.
Can you quote the movie?
I don't remember it. I saw it, but
Rescue 911. A bunch of vids, Zybots and Turtles in Time. You're a Turtles in Time guy, right?
I prefer the original.
You do?
Yeah, I do.
But
sorry.
I know, it's okay. Are you a Mortal Kombat guy?
Oh yeah, I played it a lot when I was in high school.
How about Killer Instinct?
Yeah, I actually quite enjoyed that. I mean, that was obviously after.
Right.
That was rare, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was rare.
Had a hard drive in it, I believe.
Simpsons
was good.
A lot of the young guys love all these games right here, like the Mortal Kombat, Simpsons, Turtles.
Yeah, I mean, as we were talking about earlier, a lot of the arcade games, you know, they're not as desirable, but stuff like this is still desirable.
Yeah, definitely. Like Die Hard's not desirable.
I actually like this game.
Really?
Yeah,
this game is always on Craigslist, really cheap.
I just love how crappy it looks.
It does.
I actually have this on Saturn.
You do?
I do.
I actually don't mind the little like Virtual Fighter type 3D graphics. It's kind of cool. So Bad Dudes, now that's a bad game. Oh, it's got Pac-Man in it. Gunsmoke. Arch Rivals.
It has been captured by ninjas.
Fast Break, I actually love that pin. CSI, Doctor Who, a lot of pins here. Simpsons Pinball Party. How about Hardbody? Are you a fan of that?
Never played it. Oh, no, I played it once.
You did?
Yeah.
All right, more pins over here. So, you know, GoldenEye, which is an amazing theme to me.
I actually played this game for the first time earlier today. I've never played it before.
Did you enjoy it?
It's all right. Yeah. And the art is not too bad for a Sega game.
No, not bad at all.
Look at, like, Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
Like, the playfield art is horrific on this game. Look at it. Look at his fingers.
Yeah.
Look at this
Oh, my
kid.
God. Look
this
at it.
This kid looks like Tyrell Lannister. Look at him.
Look at his... Looks like Family Guy hands.
Look at that kid. Is that the girl?
I never noticed that. Wayne Knight's hands look like Family Guy. It's Peter Griffin. All right, so over here. Demolition Man. Bunch of MAME stuff, some more Williams pins, and then over here, Ben, are kind of some cool vids, and then I want to go in that pin room real fast, and we'll look at your America's Most Haunted.
The dirty room?
Yeah, the popper room, whatever.
Oh, wait, let's see how these guys
are. Oh, yeah.
How's it going at the moment?
It's not going.
We better leave them alone.
I know, I think so.
Zip ties.
Yeah. All right, Multi-Williams, Pac-Man, RoboCop.
I
was about to say, you strike me as a RoboCop guy.
Yeah. I remember this game when it was in the arcade, and it's always cool when you can play the games for free.
Yes.
Unlike when you were 12.
Right. And a bunch of pins here. These are all 80s. Are you into the 80s stuff? 80s pins? Yeah.
Well, I have a space shuttle.
Oh, that's true. Oh,
I watched this documentary on RoboCop with Paul Verhoeven, who's like crazy.
Yeah.
He's like, RoboCop is like a Jesus in the white knight shining armor character. Because he's Dutch.
That's funny.
Yeah.
So, all right. I've never seen this one. Time Fantasy?
Yeah, I do.
You have?
This one I've never seen.
And Andromeda, I've never seen that either.
Game Plan, that was the pinball company that Roger Sharp started in the early
80s.
Yeah.
Cool. Alright, so why don't we go check out the pinball room?
Yeah.
Alright, so we're going to go over here and check out the pin room, which is the pop room where they're doing like the tournament. Pinball tournament. Are you a good pinball player?
Not really.
No? So let's just check out the games here, because I want to just look at America's Most Haunted, which is the game that Ben created. So these are all the games that are in the tournament. So over here is America's Most Haunted. So Ben, do you know if people have been putting up good scores on your game?
I have no idea.
What is a good score, do you know?
Over 100 million is
100 million?
Yeah.
Is that hard to do?
Kind of?
He's very, we should be quiet. We don't want to mess
a
up his game.
Falls over the crowd.
I love it, Ben. It's cool. Has it been well received by the pinball community?
Well, we sold them all.
You did.
What else can you ask for?
I guess that's it.
Yeah. Oh, Fathom. That's the game I was telling you about.
Yeah, so you they're going to reproduce that, huh?
Don't quote me on that, but that's what I've heard, yeah. Because this is for its age, this is actually expensive, desirable game.
Is it really?
For its age, yeah.
The artwork is sick.
Yeah. That was Greg Freres. That was one of his earlier...
That's Greg?
Yeah.
Wow.
That was back when they had to make all the artwork Ruby Lift.
Oh, yeah?
They would have to, like, cut pieces of Ruby Lift.
Yeah, Greg was telling me about that. I was asking him, like, how he used to do the art. I'm like, what? It was so abstract what he was describing.
Integrated circuits back then. They would design the integrated circuit in Ruby Lift and then photographically create it.
So, Ben, I think that's it. I think we've kind of seen pretty much everything. I mean, there's some console rooms that I showed earlier, but, well, Ben, thank you very much.
No problem.
Did you have fun?
I did. I have a seminar to get to.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye. So, I am speaking right now inside Arcade Collecting with Arcade Outsider John Jacobson. What do you think about that, Bobby?
Congratulations. I don't get my name on the
what?
I'm lumped in with like six other people. You get it all.
Where are you? Are you over here?
10 o'clock. I'm in the 10 o'clock.
You're radio free. Oh, you're podcasting after dark.
Yeah, I'm on the 10 o'clock.
It doesn't say Bobby Blackwolf anymore.
I know. And I don't get to go to the signing table.
And by the way, guys, if you know a bit of video game outsiders history and trivia, because Bobby was kind of Tiger Claw for us before Tiger Claw, right?
Yeah.
Because Bobby actually was the one that made the very first VGO live.
That's right.
Right?
And I think the second one, too.
The second one. Was that episode 100 or 50?
Yeah, I think we did 50 and then we did 100.
Right, right. And that was pretty exciting.
Yeah.
It was, wasn't it?
It was fun.
We couldn't believe how many people showed up.
I know.
It blew our mind. Like, we thought, like 10 people would be there. And it was a really good turnout when we did that.
Yeah.
It was exciting. And Bobby was a big part of that. And Bobby used to be on All Games.
Yep.
And now Bobby's not on All Games.
Right.
And now he's on Voice of Geeks.
Voice of Geeks Network. Yep.
Yep.
We're sponsoring here.
And you're sponsoring this event.
Yep. We're on signage and everything.
Right.
We're official.
So I guess I should probably be in this room.
Probably be in there.
Yeah.
And then you get to do guest table and signings and everything.
Oh, yeah.
For the line of autographs.
That's right. Very exciting.
I knew him win.
Here at the Southern Fried Gameroom Expo. Before we begin, I just want to give you another round of appreciation for coming out to the show. We wouldn't be successful without you guys, especially for all you who brought games and traveled great distances. This really means something special to me. You see a banner up here. I'm a co-host of a podcast called Gameroom Junkies.
Never heard of it.
Yeah, it's a shame. I'm not sure what's it called. But if you do, I would appreciate it. And ladies and gentlemen, you're not here for me. You are here for someone you may recognize from the video game Outsiders podcast, from Arcade Outsiders, from Kill Screens, from John's Arcade, Mr. John Jameson.
What's up, guys? By the way, thanks for coming. Seriously, I was getting a little paranoid that no one's going to be in this room.
No, I was telling John earlier that actually we're going to have quite a few people because we sent out a survey last year. Said, who do you guys want to see? Did we do a good job? What do you think? And request after request, John's Arcade, bring it. So, glad you're here.
That's pretty awesome. Thank you, guys. Hey, guys, Billy and Walter are here.
Hey, guys, Billy and Walter
here. Hi, Walter.
Hi, John.
I met you before at Richie Knuckles a long time ago. You too.
What we're about to present
we presume it's coming as a complete surprise to you.
Yeah, what's going on?
We did this all secret.
Do I have hot sauce?
Maybe somebody else should handle the camera.
There's a little news. We actually sold John on eBay. So we have to deliver them to the new owners.
You sold me on eBay?
So anyway, you know that we've been making trading cards, and you've all heard that the trading cards are not about just champions who have
Get out.
High scores. You want to leave?
No.
You know, like champions who have high scores. Actually, the trading cards intend to be a historical document of all the stuff that we've done in our lifetimes, because we are the first gamers. I mean, 500 years from now, people are still going to, civilization continues that. 500 years from now, people will still be playing some level of gaming. It will be very amazing at that time. And all of us together make up that historic moment when it did start. So we started a set of trading cards that commemorates all our contributions. And today we're going to honor John Jacobson for his incredible contribution.
Thank you very much. This is awesome. Thank you. That's awesome. Well,
essentially, for those of you who might be from other countries, which I think is all of you, trading cards are an ancient American tradition. So we are now enrolling you in an ancient.
Well, thank you, Walter. I have thousands of them in my basement that are worthless.
Video game trading.
Did you say your basement's worthless?
No. Oh. I have thousands of 90s baseball cards. You want them in the late 80s?
Well, so anyway, as I've said numerous times, when we present the trading card's not printed yet because we did this so fast right before the
show. Oh.
But we have your award. We give out an award.
Oh, thank you.
We're honoring you for this. And I like to think that since this is part of an ancient American tradition, I like to believe that the spirits of like Joe DiMaggio and Mickey Mantle and, you know, Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig are here joining us as we welcome.
Those are my heroes, by the way. You named all my baseball heroes. Yep, Billy Martin.
As we all gather to welcome you in, enroll you in a trading card. So we're going to have a trading card for him. It won't be here this weekend. We're going to have to send it to him. But we'll make sure that everybody can get them eventually. So let's actually stand and thank them on behalf of, you know, all of us.
It's too much.
Sorry, that was quite a battle over there, Patrick.
Did you win?
I'm Billy Mitchell. The truth is, when we started doing the trading cards, the neatest thing is, as I always say, everywhere you go and everything you read, they say, oh, this programmer, this developer, they honor a certain group. They don't honor people that create or participate or further the culture, that promote the hobby, that push forward. Usually, it's a very unselfish person that's pushing forward. Usually, it's someone who makes somewhere between little and nothing as far as money off it.
I would agree.
Yeah. How about you all? But the fact of the matter is, those are the people that keep the hobby alive, push it forward, and create venues like this, where we all go back to what it is we enjoyed so much. And it's one of the things we like best, is we begin to meet people on a deeper level, people that are literally more important than the other people who are normally honored. So, your trading card is in the works.
Thank you.
The award awarding you and recognizing you is here. And on behalf of the industry as a whole, and everybody who you have participated with and pushed forward in the industry.
Thank you.
Is.
That is awesome. Woo! Thank you so much. Thank you, Walter. I'm floored by this.
Thank you very much.
Honestly, thank you. I didn't think I was on your radar, Walter. Brett, did you do this? So honestly, I cannot believe this. I mean, I've been aware of the trading cards for a long time, and I've seen my peers on them. But I'm really excited to join everyone that has these cards. I mean, it is absolutely an honor. So thank you so much. I mean, it's awesome.
Let me say something about
that. Yes.
By the way, these awards, we got very involved in the trading card industry now, and the rest of them are blown away because no one in the trading card industry also gives awards, honors the people if they receive their cards. So this is actually very special, and we're very, very excited that we've been able to do this. But what's so interesting about this is that because we are all here right now, we actually don't quite have a clear perspective on how big of a deal all of our contributions really are, how big of a deal they truly are. And that I predict that his award here, that five generations, seven generations from now, some great-great-great-grandchild is going to have hanging on the wall. And when their neighbors come in and say, what is that? They're going to be so proud to say that my great-great-grandfather, John Jacobson, he was part of the birth of video games. So let's hear it for John.
One of the things that's really neat is it absolutely cements his place in history. It's not just people talking, it's here, it's in writing, it's real. It's something people can hold and trade. He's actually number 2,396. That's his card number.
What number are you,
so
Billy?
So there's only 2,395 people more important than
that's
him.
That's right. Yeah. And which card are you?
I'm number one.
Are you really?
I don't want to say anything, unfortunately, we're going to have to wrap this one up, but I do want to say thank you to Walter Day, to Mr. Bill Mitchell. Mr. Billy Mitchell's plug-in, that we are going to have something coming up.
We need people in depth, we need people who are trying to further the industry. They're putting out movies that aren't quite on the market yet. So, in here, correct, at 5:30, there's a trailer that's not even on the internet for No Princess in the Castle. Hopefully everybody will be here to see it, because I've supplied Preston with plenty of hot sauce and plenty of posters that he'll be giving away, and he'll tell you how to get those. It's not very difficult.
I appreciate it, guys. So John's gonna have some t-shirts. I think he might be selling them, and we
thank
also
you.
Have
thank
a
you.
Signer
thank you very much.
Out front where you'll
appreciate
find-
amazing. So, you is Mike, right?
Yeah, that's you.
Brother Mike.
Or Brother John.
Gave me a Brother John award.
Yeah, now my name's Joel Logan.
Oh, you're Joel, that's right, sorry. Brother John, 2015 Brown Paint Award of Excellence. Dude, this is awesome.
And since Atlanta's also the home of Coca-Cola.
But they have Pepsi here, drink. Which is weird.
Yeah, but this is the home of Coca-Cola. It's blasphemy to drink Pepsi in the state of Georgia.
Is it?
So we also got you a few little snacks.
Oh, dude, awesome. Thank you so much, man. Thank you very much. Look at that.
No one can see what you've got.
That's awesome. Thank you.
I don't believe we don't belong. No one can see what we've got. Well, I wake up in the morning and you're not right next to me. I feel incomplete.
All right, guys, I think that's gonna do it for Southern Fried Gameroom Expo. Why don't we go back to the basement? Actually, before we go, let's say hi to these guys. Preston and Patrick.
Hey, what's up, guys?
What's up, guys? It's Patrick and Preston from Gameroom Junkies podcast.
Yeah, man. Yep.
These guys put this show on. Is that right?
Yeah, we're the...
And you guys nailed it, man.
We had three other organizers that helped us, but yeah.
But it was your idea. You created this thing. This is your show.
Yeah, we started the show because there wasn't anything in Atlanta, man. So we just said, hey, let's put one down.
Awesome. And I mean, honestly, I love it here. I told you before, I love the vibe. Everyone's just so nice, and it just feels good. Yeah, it feels good in here. I agree. There is Southern hospitality going on.
Something for everybody. Man.
Yes, it feels good. We got the consoles, we got the pinballs, the video games. Like you said, something for everybody. So, what's your favorite thing here? Do you have anything?
Oh, man. So, I got to play the Kiss pinball machine for the first time.
Yes.
It was really cool. I love the new stuff. I love modded things.
The modded stuff?
So, we just gave some Best of Show awards to a Simpsons that was fully restored, lighted stuff.
Really?
It was really slick. And then a pinball machine, Genesis.
Yeah, I saw that.
But it was all modded out with LEDs and a new back glass.
All translate and all that. Yeah.
And EL wire, so yeah, those
new
things
rams.
Are cool.
New rams?
Yeah.
So what was your favorite game, Patrick?
Oh, my favorite game is, I like the mods too, and I have a Data East Star Wars game.
Yeah.
And they have one back here with a PIM sound card in it, and they've completely redone the soundtrack and put the original John Williams score in the soundtrack. And
is it just like playing all the time? Does the soundtrack?
No, I mean, it's on cue. Yeah, just parts of it.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's fantastic.
Well, guys, thank you again for having me. Seriously, I'm honored that I was here. I really had a great time.
Awesome. We're glad to have you, man.
It was so fun, man. So
thanks for coming.
All right, guys, let's go back to the basement. What'd you think? Pretty fun, right? I gotta say, again, you know, just everybody that I met down there was absolutely awesome and super cool. It's just, it's different down there. You know, it's the South. Everyone's cool and nice, and I just had such a great time. So thanks again to Preston and Patrick from Gameroom Junkies for allowing me to go down there and speak. You know, guys, I'd love to do it again next year because it really was fun. So, and of course, thanks to Ben Heck for hanging out with me. I really like Ben. And maybe we'll do another Ben Heck video. I'd like to maybe visit him in next month. We'll see what happens. I need to reach out to him and see if that's possible. I'd like to visit Ben Heck's shop, which is in Wisconsin, because I usually go home for Thanksgiving in Chicago area, and it wouldn't be too far for me to go up there. So we'll see what happens. I need to reach out to Ben and see if he's up for that. I know I kind of talked to him a little bit when down in Atlanta. But anyway, hope you guys enjoyed the video. Again, I just want to thank everyone I met down there. Everyone was so nice. Thanks, Joel, for the award. I should show you guys my little Twin Galaxies poster. Where is that thing? Hang on a second. So here's the little poster thing I got here, and it's a Trading Card Award Ceremony, Superstars of 2015, John Jacobson, award-winning video game podcaster. Signed by Walter Day and Billy Mitchell. I mean, when this happened, guys, when I'm, you know, because I was just speaking, all of a sudden Walter Day and Billy Mitchell walk into my little thing, and they hand me my own trading card. I mean, that's awesome. So I was just floored. Signed by Preston, Billy Mitchell, Joel West. Joel West was the guy with the berserk. He was in that Chasing Ghost movie, and then Walter Day, of course. But I was totally flattered and floored by this. So thank you. Thank you, everybody. I don't have the trading cards yet. I need to reach out to Walter and give him my address so I can get the actual trading cards, and maybe I'll give them away to you guys. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video. So I want to do some viewer mail, and I'm drinking Apple Teeny Crystal Light. No, it's not alcoholic. It's just like Kool-Aid. Not bad. Anyway, I want to do some viewer mail. Oh, by the way, I want to show you guys this stuff. A guy on Clav, his handle escapes me. He has a company called Arcade Tools, and he said he saw in my videos I'm always using a channel locks to undo the buttons, and I've been doing that forever. I use this giant channel locks to get the buttons off control panels because they have those really big PAL nuts. And he made a tool, a wrench here, an arcade push button wrench, 1 1/8 and 15/16 laser cut aluminum, fits all arcade button fasteners, including PAL nuts, made in the USA. So he sent me one of these laser cut tools that he sells. Just Google like Arcade Tools or go on Clav. He's selling these on Clav. And this looks like it'll be pretty handy to remove PAL nuts. And I haven't tried it yet. I actually just got it today. But I think there's actually a need for this tool because I do always use channel locks, and it's really clumsy, you know, to use that giant tool to get in there to remove the nuts off buttons. So I this is a good idea. I think he sells these for $10. And it's a nice piece of metal, and you know, it'd kind of be better though if maybe it had a little bend to it. I don't know, so you can kind of, if this was like bent up like that, I don't know, maybe I can bend it, I don't know. Because it seems like it might be hard to get on there like this. But we'll see, we'll try it out the next time we rebuild a control panel. But thank you, Arcade Tools, for sending me this. And then also, I just want to share something with you guys, because someone on Clav, I don't know who it was either. It was a guy up in... where was he? Down south somewhere, like North Carolina or something. I guess he did a warehouse raid or something, and he was selling a bunch of really cool deco stuff. And Deco was a Data East system. It was cassette based with a literally a cassette, and it would load the ROM code off of a cassette. And of course, Data East, made Burger Time and Lock and Chase and stuff like that. And in the States, Burger Time was pretty much distributed by Bally Midway over here, because this was the cabinet that we had in Japan, in the USA. It was the Bally Midway Burger Time. So this is the cabinet that we got in the U.S. It was the Bally Midway cabinet with this artwork and Peter Pepper and all that good stuff. And Data East made the game and they licensed it to Bally Midway. And then they also, Data East kind of came in the States and were selling these Deco conversion kits. Maybe before the Bally Midway one was released, I'm not sure, but they were conversion kits. They had the cassette system and then their own Data East artwork. And so this guy in Club was selling these Deco kits. I think in Japan, everything was Deco. Obviously, there's no Bally Midway. So this is the artwork that they had in Japan for Burger Time. And I just think this is the coolest artwork ever. It just makes me happy. Look at this. I think it's just so rad. And this is all original. This thing is beautiful. This guy was selling this for $25. And I've kind of dreamed about having a Data East Deco Burger Time, like, forever. I mean, if I were to find a Data East Burger Time, I would, in a heartbeat, get rid of the Bally Midway one, because I just think this is so wild. So I've got the first part here. and the Deco cabinets were pretty much generic. They had, you would swap out the marquee, and then the bezel was generic, and the control panel was generic, and the sides of the cabinet were generic, and then you could change out the cassette and the marquee to change the game. But I don't know, I just think this is so cool, and this is beautiful for all original. And then it also came with this here, which I believe is maybe a cocktail instruction card. And then it also came with instructions and this nice little bag. So this bag right here, everything was in this sleeve, that was part of the kit. And it also came with the game explanation sheet right here. I don't know, for $25, I had to grab this because it's beautiful. And it says how to change a cocktail game. It just talks about this little conversion kit, changing the cassette, cocktail table upright, changing the cassette and the artwork and all that stuff. Looks like you needed maybe change some ROMs too, I'm not sure. But he also had the Burger Time Deco, ROMs and cassette, and someone grabbed it before me. I didn't get it. So anyway, I have the first part here for my Deco, if I ever find the cabinet, which they do come up from time to time. I was talking to John Exidy about maybe getting his Deco cabinet. He's actually has the multi, I probably shouldn't tell you guys this, but I don't want you going to get it because I want it. So I've been talking about maybe getting that Deco. I don't know, we'll see. I just can't swing it right now. All right, enough rambling. Let's do some viewer mail. I printed up three of them. And by the way, if you want to participate in the viewer mail segment, you need to email them to me at blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blackdog7@gmail.com. blkdog7@gmail.com. All right, first one here. And by the way, in the subject line, you got to put viewer mail. All right, this one's from Demo. Hey, John, I'm a big fan of Robotron, and I'm jealous of your cabinet. I was wondering, have you ever played its sequel, Blaster? It's one of my favorites. It has an iRobot feel. Have you ever come across a Blaster cabinet? They were made of plastic and were pretty cool looking. I heard a story that the plastic, due to the game warming up, would shrink. Well, if it warmed up, it would expand. The monitor would pop out across the room like a missile. Is this true? LOL. I believe they are rare. Would love to own one. I know you have a lot of projects in the garage, but it would be really cool to see you restore an all-plastic cabinet such as Blaster. VidKids rule. Yes, VidKids, of course, is Eugene Jarvis and Larry DeMar. They made Robotron and Blaster, Stargate Defender. These guys are legendary. Okay, so yes. So yes, I love Robotron, too. I have one over here. I believe that Robotron is the best Williams video game, and that's why I have it down here. I used to have the J-Rock multi-Williams in a Bubbles cabinet, and that was a lot of fun. It did have Blaster on it. I did play Blaster. Blaster's a cool, pseudo 3D game. Yes, very much like iRobot, with these oversized 3D sprites and stuff. But, for my money, Robotron is the way to go, and I love this thing. And actually, this winter, we should replace the control panel overlay. I actually have one, in the a brand new one, ready to go on. We should strip this and get that back up, back in shape there. But anyway, So have I seen a blaster cabinet? Actually, yeah, because last November when I was in Chicago, we went to Joe Majera's, and Joe Majera had a black blaster cabinet, and he also had the much rarer wooden blaster cabinet. So go back and watch that video. I'll put a link in the show notes, because Joe had the blaster, the plastic one, the Duramold, they call it. You know, they had these... Williams thought it'd be cool to do like an injection molded cabinet, and they did like Bubbles and Blaster. I don't know if they did any other games besides those two. I'm not sure, but the Bubbles one is blue, the Blasters one is black. I know they did some other games, but anyway, those are the two I'm most familiar with. But Joe had the black plastic Duramold blaster cabinet, and I was absolutely in love with it. Like honestly, that was like when I went to Joe's, that was the game that I was drooling at over. I'm like, man, I need to get me one of those. So if I ever had a chance to get a Duramold blaster, I think I would probably jump on it. The wood one that Joe had is even rarer. They made more of the plastic ones. The wood one is also stunning as well. So yeah, Blaster is definitely a cool underrated game. If you guys have never tried it, definitely tried it. MAME, it's pretty neat. And that was one that I did enjoy on the J-Rock. But at the end of the day, man, for me, it's all about Robotron. So, all right, next one is from KM13. Hey, John, I like your videos. They help with so many things, and they're also fun. I am building a Miss Pac-Man from scratch. I found everything except the coin door. I need the coin door, the coin counter, basically all of the guts of a Midway coin door. All right, here's my question. Where do you find a Midway coin door with all of the guts? I need a little help. John, I was inspired by you to do this. I think this will be a fun, good experience. This is my first time. Keep up the good work. Sincerely, KM13. You know, the Midway coin doors, man, those are easy to find. They're not super rare. They're really not. And, what would I do? Well, I would do a couple things, okay? Actually, we'll go over here and look at the one on the Burger Time. What I would do, and this is the Midway coin door right here, that would be the same era as Pac-Man or Miss Pac-Man right there. And it has like a little Midway name badge. Now, someone has reproed this name badge, you know, so you could just buy the name badge and a generic coin door, but that's not as cool. But here's the good news. These coin doors are super common. I mean, it is not a hard part to find, okay? So I would make a wanted to buy post on Clove, okay? And then I would also be looking at eBay, and another good place to try is Arcade Boneyard. Now, you say you want the coin counter. Is the coin counter on the door itself? I don't remember. I guess we could go look at the journey over here. I don't know. I wouldn't lose sleep if you don't get the coin counter. So let's see in here. Is there coin counter in here? I don't remember. Oh yeah, the coin counter is right here. So I would just look on eBay. This is the kind of thing that you can find on eBay pretty easily. You know, it's, again, it's not rare. Every one of these Bally Midway games had this coin door with the coin counter, you know. It's really common. I would check arcadeboneyard.com. I would post on Clove. I would also check on eBay. And I think that you should be able to find that relatively quickly within a month or two. It's not going to take you forever to find that part. That's super common. And, you know, if it doesn't add the coin counter, I don't think I'd lose sleep over that unless you really want that. But that's what I would do. I would just kind of go to the obvious places like Clove, Craigslist, eBay, and even Arcade Boneyard, because Arcade Boneyard, that guy, like, he basically removes all the parts off arcade games and sells them. It's not really awesome that he's doing that, but it is a service that is kind of needed. My track and field control panel came from him. I couldn't find one anywhere, and then he had one on his website. It was a conversion. It was a track and field control panel with some other artwork on it. I stripped it, and that's what's on my game over there, because I could not find a track and field control panel anywhere. All right, the next one here is from Chris. It says, I just acquired this game, and it is my first arcade game. I came across your video. Oh, by the way, it's in his subject line. It is a single monitor Nintendo Play Choice. Okay, so I guess the question here is, did it original dedicated? Okay, which is the same cabinet profile as R-Type and also that Nintendo Versus game we restored in the garage. Is it a dedicated one? or is it a Donkey Kong conversion? Because they're out there, okay? And he says, like, anyway, I came across your video doing the cap replacement on the Sanyo 20EZ. I have a couple quick questions. I cannot find a sticker anywhere in the monitor denoted it as a 20EZ. There's a sticker on the tube saying it's a Sanyo. Then on the lower part of the sticker, this other number, you know, it's 510UTB22. From that, it can be can it be assumed that it's a 20EZ because it has those Sanyo stickers? From your video, mine looks nearly identical. I have not yet removed it from the cabinet. The monitor is currently dead, so I'm assuming it will need a new flyback, hot, and we'll do the caps just because I know the 300 milliamp fuse is blown. I need to get it out so I can check the rest of the fuses. The thing sat unused for unknown amount of time in a barn. I found that the internal plug that is supposed to be 100 volts is actually registering 108. Is that normal or a sign of a transformer is bad? The good news is the computer seems okay so far as it boots up and its LED on the board is solid. Did the PlayChoice 10 have an LED on it? I don't remember. I used to have a dedicated single monitor God, this stupid door. I used to have a dedicated single monitor PlayChoice and I do not remember that PCB having an LED on it. I suppose it's possible, but I just don't remember that. And, but maybe it did. I don't know. Did it? I don't think it did. I never seen any Nintendos with LEDs on the monitor. Anyway, so he wants to know if he has a 20EZ in his PlayChoice. Well, the odds are really good, okay? I'll tell you this. My single monitor PlayChoice actually had a Wells Gardner. I had a, from the factory, a Wells Gardner K7000 in it. So Nintendo, basically, as far as I know, it's going to be one of three monitors, okay? It's going to be a Sanyo 20EZ or a Sharp XM20, whatever, the 19-inch Sharp monitor, or a Wells Gardner. Now, the Sharp and the Sanyo are pretty much identical. The parts are interchangeable. In Punch-Out, you'll find the Sharps a lot. You just cap them as if they're Sanyo 20EZs. The kits are, they overlap and they're the same, okay? So it's either a Sharp, a Sanyo, or a Wells Gardner. If it's got Sanyo stickers on it, odds are it's definitely not the Wells Gardner. So I think it's a pretty safe bet it's a 20EZ. And if it looks just like the one in my video, then it's a 20EZ. Now, I do think that you're on the right track here because the fuse is blown. Usually the fuse blows on those monitors when the hot or the flyback go out. And that's an indicator that one of those two parts are bad. So when I get a monitor like that, a 20EZ, I shotgun the whole thing. I replace all of the caps, I replace the hot, and I replace the flyback. And 9 times out of 10, it's gonna fix the issue. And then after you do all that, you wanna check your B+ voltage. I have a video on that. You might also want to replace the filter cap just for the heck of it. If you go to iankellogg.com, he's got the cap kits and all that stuff, the filter caps, he can hook you up. So yes, Chris, I think you are on the right path here. I would go ahead, replace the hot, the flyback, all the capacitors, and even the filter cap. Check your B+, and I bet you anything that thing will come right back to life. So, all right, guys, that's gonna do it for the viewer mail. So anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Guys, I'm getting worried. I'm scared. It's cold. It is freezing outside. It is like so freaking cold. So we finished the, the Nintendo Versus Restore completely. There is a video I filmed that I can't show you guys just yet. Okay, I did it with Adam and we kind of finished off the Nintendo Versus project fully. Now again, this is a top secret project. I can't tell you who the game is for or what the game is just yet. So after the person gets the game, then I will release the reveal video. Right now the game is all wrapped up in the garage, ready to go to San Francisco. That's a clue right there. Actually, you guys wanna see? You wanna see the game? Let's go in the garage. I'll show you guys it all wrapped up, ready to go. All right, let's go on here. I'll show you guys what's going on. So here's the game all wrapped up. It is ready to go. It's going to San Francisco. I'm waiting for National Van Lines, NAVL, to come pick it up. So I wrapped the living heck out of this thing. There's a moving blanket underneath it, and then there's cardboard over the moving blanket, and then a whole lot of shrink wrap. And I even put little notes on here. Do not use hand cart on this side. Yes, you can use the hand cart on this side right here because this is the back. And then do not use it on this side. Okay, this is the side. I don't want the hand cart here. And then the front, definitely do not use it because there's glass right here. So, you know, I'm just a little worried. I want this game to get there in one piece because honestly,
I spent a lot of time making this thing perfect. I really did. And it really turned out great. And I'll show you guys the reveal video. So I'm really excited for this thing to leave, and I'm also excited for the person to get the game. So anyway, I just wanted to show you guys it all wrapped, and it's gonna be leaving very soon, hopefully in the next couple days here. But I'm so relieved to be done with this, but now this means that we need to work on this stuff. But it is like 40 degrees outside right now. So what I'm thinking is this, okay? I might give up on the Quantum for 2015. I know it sucks, okay? But the writing is on the wall, guys. I mean, it's almost November here. There's no way I'm gonna be able to finish that game. I don't know, I'll try. I think the safest thing to do right now is to get this in the basement. I know you guys want me to work on computer space, and believe me, I want to as well. So I think I'm gonna bring computer space into the basement, and we're gonna work on it in the basement this year. Firefox, I want that to go in the basement also, because Franz is almost done with the Laserdisc player, so we can bring that down, okay? And then over here, iRobot is so close to being done also. We got the bezel done. Actually, one of my viewers who owns a body shop has volunteered to fix this for me, so I'm gonna mail this to him probably tomorrow. And maybe we'll get that back in a week, and then this thing is gonna be really ready for the basement. Now, there are some cosmetic issues on the bottom. Maybe I let those go and just get the game in the basement because I'm running out of time. So I don't know. I think iRobot is the smarter way to go right now, because it requires less work and it's closer to being done. And then Firefox, same thing. There's nothing wrong with this. It's beautiful. It looks nice. I just need the Laserdisc player back from Franz. And if Franz doesn't pan out, maybe I get one of the Dextra boards. I don't know. So anyway, and then sadly, I think Quantum's gonna have to wait till the spring, which will be here before you know it, and then Pro Moldico over here is just gonna have to rot in the garage this winter. Same thing with Bronco, we just don't have time. I do like Bronco though. So anyway, yeah, I just wanted to show you guys this, and we got a little sidetracked there, but so just relieved, and I'm getting scared because it's getting very cold, but let's go back down to the basement. So yeah, that's what we're doing. That's the plan. We gotta get that stuff down here. I think the dartboard's gonna go, and then I need to get rid of some other game. I just don't know yet which one is gonna leave, but I think the dart, and also I gotta fix stuff down here. What's going on here? This monitor's busted, Tron's broken. So maybe this week we'll pull out the Street Fighter and see if we can get that monitor fixed, and then maybe we'll do the Tron the same night. I don't know, but we got to get this stuff fixed, because I have a policy down here that I keep up with stuff. You know, if something breaks, I fix it immediately, because otherwise stuff starts stacking, and I'm going against my policy because I've got two things down. So anyway, all right, guys, that's gonna do it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks again to everyone in Atlanta. You guys are all amazing. Preston, go listen to Gameroom Junkies podcast. Just a really just nice guys. There's nothing bad to say about those guys. They're just super cool. Preston, I love Preston. So, I guess you could listen to my podcast, Video Game Outsiders at videogameoutsiders.com, and of course, Arcade Outsiders at arcadeoutsiders.com. I think we're gonna do a podcast this week on Thursday. So we're kind of settling in on Thursdays at 10 p.m. Eastern for our podcast, for Arcade Outsiders. And we'll be streaming that at if you go to arcadeoutsiders.com, I have all the streaming information there. And of course, you know, I just got back from Grinkers. I had an awesome time with Joe and Fett, and just everyone that came to that event. That was a massive success. You guys saw all the videos. I posted like 6 videos from there, and just so much fun. Again, everyone in this hobby is so cool. So thanks to everyone that came out to Grinkers, because that really was a great time. It was just a blur. It's just so much going on at these events, especially Grinkers, because it's like a bar, there's drinking, there's games, there's people, and it's kind of a compressed area, and it's just like, for like 3 days, and then you come home here, and you're just like coming down off this, like, whatever, just sensory overload. But I had a lot of fun, and thanks to everyone that came out. So, all right, that's gonna do it for this video. I'll see you guys very soon. Actually, sooner than later, maybe Wednesday or Thursday. I think we should attack one of these games. I think the Hyper Fighting, that Street Fighter one, I think I know exactly what's wrong with it. I think there's a transistor on the neck board that is bad, or trace from heat. We might be able to pull that out and reflow the solder and fix it. I don't know.
I don't know if I have those transistors on hand. I'm pretty sure it's a K7000. If not, I have some junk chassis in the garage. We could probably pull a transistor off. But anyway, enough of that, guys. I'll see you very soon. Thanks for watching. Subscribe, like, tell all your friends, whatever. Follow me on Twitter, BLKDOG7, Instagram, John's Arcade, all that good stuff. So, all right, guys, that's it for this video. I'll see you very soon. Later, and bye.
You going?
All right, guys, we are now here in Atlanta at the Southern Fried Gameroom Expo, and Ben Heck is here. Here he is. It's Ben.
Hello, hello.
Guys, ready?
Let me try to get that white out, maybe.
We can move this way.
So it's
okay.
Yeah, it is pretty bright.
All right, let me get you in a little. Right there.
Ready?
Yep.
Level's okay?
Hello?
Yes.
Say something.
Hello? Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, good. All right, you recording? All right, guys, we are here in Atlanta at the Southern Fried Gameroom Expo, and Ben Heck is here.
I am.
Ben, you are here.
This is my first time visiting Atlanta, actually.
Mine too. What do you think?
Well, I just remember the Futurama episode where they're like, Atlanta, home of an even bigger Delta Hub.
So anyway, we're here, and Erie is here. Here he is.
I am.
So we transformed our Skype conversation to... stop it. I don't want to do that over you. Sorry, I ruined your... So you can see Ben's not pressing the button. He's doing it with his hand, and it's totally working. That is awesome, Ben.
Thanks.